Hi everyone, welcome to Financial Reporting. Today we are going to look at a major standard. We are going to look at IFRS, or we call it IFRS number 9, Financial Instrument. Yes, this chapter is gigundous, I mean humongous, but together we're going to normalize the abnormal. So when it comes to initial recognition, when do you recognize the financial instruments? What about classification? What about derecognition? Initially, we recognize the financial instruments when the entity becomes part to the contractual provision of the instruments, right? But what are financial instruments? Financial instrument, we say, is any contract that gives rise to two things. Is any contract that gives rise to a financial asset and a financial liability or equity instrument. I can give you an example. We say we might have entity A and entity B. Entity A might give a loan. For example, let's say they decide to give a loan to entity B, and then they say maybe the agreement is 4 years. They expect entity B to repay after 4 years. So when entity A looks at entity B, they will say that entity B is our trade receivable. When entity B looks at entity A, they'll say entity A is the trade payable. You get it? So, but in the financial statements, in the financial position, when you look at the statement of financial position, we do have non-current assets. We do have current assets. But when you say we have a receivable, it does not mean that we are going to record the trade receivables in the current assets. Because the trade receivables that you do record in the current assets are those customers who have purchased the goods on credit. But what are we doing here? These are not goods, right? So a financial instrument is any contract that gives rise to financial asset and financial liability or equity instrument. So this standard, this standard IFRS 9, it excludes the physical assets such as inventory. It excludes PPE, property, plant and equipment. We don't include also even intangible assets, because they have to be a contract, you get it. Even any asset or liability that is not contractual in nature is not covered by IFRS 9 financial instrument, right? So let's say it gives loan to entity B. Entity A is going to record a financial asset. We are going to record what? The financial asset. What about entity B? They will say we have the financial liability. So it gives rise to two things: financial asset and financial liability. What is a financial asset? A financial asset, we say, is any asset that is cash. Or we say you have the contractual right to receive the cash. For example, entity A has a contractual right to receive the cash. Or we say, if you are the one who is receiving, we say you can exchange the financial instruments under the conditions that are potentially favorable to the entity. But if you have the financial liability, you say a financial liability now, remember you are not receiving the cash, but you are the one who you have to pay, you are supposed to pay the cash in the future. So we say there is a contractual obligation to deliver the cash. Or we say you can exchange the financial instruments under the conditions that are potentially unfavorable to the entity because of the financial liability. All right. I think it's right time to extend the idea. Let us look at a question. Want to do a question?
All right, people. This is the question that we want to look at. Question number 96. What is the requirement? What are you required to do? They are saying what amount to be credited to equity on 1 April 2005. What amount will be credited to equity on 1 April 2005? An 8% 30 million convertible loan was issued. All right. So I want to look at this question. This is the question, people. When you are given a question like this, the first thing is to discount your amounts to present value.
An 8% 30 million convertible loan note was issued on 1 April 2005. And they want us to calculate the amount that will be credited to equity on 1 April 2005, right? If you look at the question, they are saying interest is payable in arrears on 31st of March each year. So we are paying at the year end, right? So we have the loan note is redeemable at par on 31 March 2008. So it will be redeemable on 31 March 2008. And it was issued on 1 April 2005. The period there, we do have 3 years, right? So, or it will be convertible. So the type of loan that was issued is a convertible loan note. A convertible loan note has two options. It's either it will be redeemed or it will be converted into shares. So the debt holder will choose either to receive the loan or to have the shares. But when you are doing the financial instrument, we don't use an assumption that it will be converted into shares. So forget that statement. Where they are saying it will be converted into shares, what? Right. They are saying a similar instrument without the conversion option. Yes, exactly. We say we use an assumption that the loan will not be converted into shares. So there is a similar instrument without the conversion option. So I want to know the interest rate of that similar instrument. It has the interest rate of 1% of 10%. So that means we are going to take 10%. We are given two interest here. We have 8% and 10%. So when you are going to discount your cash flows, you are going to use the rate at which the loan will not be converted into shares. So that means you are going to use 10%, not 8%. 8% is just there in order to confuse you. Right. So the first thing that I do when we are doing the financial instrument is to calculate the cash flows, the amount that I will be paying each and every year end. So there is a percentage that is attached to the loan. So the percentage that is attached is 8%. So I'll say 8% of 30 million. 8% of 30 million, that will be 2.4 million. This is the amount that you'll be paying per year, all right? What about the opening obligation? So this 30 million is not my opening obligation because we are given the discount factor. I have to discount those amounts. Yeah. Cash flow. Discount factor, which is 10%. And I do have the present value. The first year end, my first year end, that will be 31st of March. We took a loan on 1 April 2005, so that would be 2006, 31 March 2007, 31 March 2008. On 31 March 2006, how much are we going to pay? We'll pay 2.4, okay, this will be million, right? We'll pay 2.4. We'll pay here, we'll pay 2.4. What about 31 2008? Pay 2.4. Why pay 2.4? On this year, you are going to pay the interest. 2007, you pay the interest. Then in 2008, that's when the loan will be redeemed. So that means you don't just pay the interest, who also repay the loan amount. In other words, this is 2.4 plus the loan amount that you took. All right? So these are the future values. We have not yet paid these amounts, but these are the amounts that we are going to pay in the future. So these are the future values. So we need to discount those amounts to present value, right? Because money loses value with time. So we have to apply the time value of money concept. So we have to discount these amounts to know exactly the amount that we will pay. So that amount that we'll pay, we'll call it the opening obligation. What is our opening obligation? What is our opening obligation? So if you look at the question, these are the discount rates. So if you do the number crunching exercise on your adding machine, you get this amount. If you multiply, you get this amount. If you sum up all this, you get 28.476. So they want the amount that you are going to credit to equity. So this is the opening obligation because they have not yet paid the amount. So how much did you receive? We received 30 million, right? And when you pay, this will be the amount that you pay after this amount, after a year, after 3 years in total. So if you compare the difference, that will be the equity option. This will be the amount that will be credited to equity, which is 1.524 million. And your answer will be B. Then, want to do the last question where we prepare the amortization table. Let's do the last question.
Right. This is the question that you want to look at. Question number 97. This is the question, people. This is the question. All right, let's push boundaries.
All right, question 97, they're saying a 5% loan note. So the percentage that is attached to the loan amount, that's 5%. I say the first thing that you do, you calculate the cash flow, right? So cash flow, that will be what? The cash flow, 5% of the loan amount that you took. So we have 20 million. So of 20 million, 5% of this amount, that will be what? That will be 1 million. So 1,000, I remove 3 zeros. Then they are saying we took a loan on 100,000. The direct cost of the issue were 500,000. All right? The loan will be redeemed on 31st of March 2003. So it will be redeemed after 3 years, right? It is a substantial premium. There is an effective interest rate of 10%. They are saying at what amount will be the loan, will the loan not appear in the statement of financial position? In other words, they want us to calculate the closing obligation. We have the opening obligation. So what is the opening obligation? Our opening obligation is the loan, the amount that we took. So we have 20 million less what? We have 20 million less the direct cost. So for you to receive 20 million, you incurred the cost of 500,000. You incurred the cost of 500,000. That means you will be left with 19,500. Then you prepare this table, the amortization table. So the difference between this question and the previous question that you looked at is you are not given the discount factors.
therefore you're not going to discount any amount.
So this is the amortization table. I will have my year end, my opening obligation, effective interest. What's the effective interest rate? That's 10%. Cash flow and the closing obligation. So we took a loan on 1 April 2000. So the first year end, that would be 31st of March 2001.
Yes, sir.
2001. Then the following year, 31 March 2002. Then 31 March 2003. This is the last year because it will be redeemed on 31 March 2003. Your opening obligation. What if I put 3 zeros here? 3 zeros here. Allow me to do that. 3 zeros here. Yes, sir. But the question wants us to calculate the loan amount that will appear on 31 March 2002. Look at this date. So when you are doing financial reporting, please make sure that you pay attention to dates. So you need to master two things, the standard and the dates. The standard and the dates. Right. So this is the year. We need the closing obligation on 31st of March 2002. My opening obligation, 19,500, easy. Plus the interest rate, because it increases your balance. 10% of this amount. The cash flow, this is the amount that you pay every year end. So I've already calculated. So this will be in brackets because it reduces. When you pay your balance, the balance that you're owing, it reduces, right? So allow me to do this even in the following year. So if you sum up this, what do I get? If I do the number crunching on my adding machine, if I do the number crunching on my adding machine, I'll get 2450. The closing obligation in 2001, it will be the opening obligation in 2002. Then you add the interest of 10%, 2045. So I have the net amount of 21495. This will be my, this is the solution. This will be your answer. Alright people, that's it. Then also on financial instrument, you also need to know about the classification of financial instruments, where we need to know whether you classify it amortized cost or at fair value through other comprehensive income, or even at fair value through profit or loss. But I won't teach you about the business model approach. The business model approach, normally you look at it when you are doing strategic business reporting, but when you're answering financial reporting, you just need to know the basics.